everybody. My name is Stephanie Warner. I'm Manager of Environmental Services with the City of Coquitlam. And I've been part of this initiative for many years now, actually. A little over seven years. And it has been an absolute privilege for me to be part of this initiative and working with all of you, those who I know directly, many of you I still have yet to meet. But what a wonderful experience this is. Thank you all for being here to share this experience, to share your knowledge, your passion, your heart. It's amazing, and I thank you for your effort and for all the hours that all of you put into making this what it has become. We've been through a lot of growth, a lot of forming, and our success is real, and it's being noticed. It's being noticed across the province. It's being noticed across the country. So we have so much to be proud of. We have so much more work to do, and I'm grateful to be in your company to carry this work on. So thank you for being here. I am now going to introduce our first keynote speaker, Mr. Kim Stevens. He told me I could say whatever I wanted, but I'm going to stick to the bio I've been given. Kim Stevens is an engineer planner and the executive director of the Partnership for Water Sustainability in BC. His four decades of experience cover the spectrum of water resource and infrastructure engineering issues. He specializes in public policy and its implementation, and has played a leadership role in a series of initiatives in British Columbia related to water sustainability, rainwater management, and green infrastructure. Since 2003, Kim has been responsible for developing and delivering the Water Sustainability Action Plan for British Columbia, the partnership umbrella for an array of top-down and bottom-up initiatives that promote a water-centric approach to community planning and development. Kim Stevens has received international recognition for his pioneering efforts and has been invited to speak on the British Columbia experience and make keynote presentations at forums in Australia and throughout North America. Please join me in welcoming Kim Stevens.
Can you hear me okay in the back if I don't need the microphone?
Yeah.
Well, you can hear me okay. Maybe you can't see me every so often. I'm right behind there. But anyway, going to Brie, it's a pleasure. And I've come all the way from Bowdoin to be here this morning. So, and I see Eric is from Lane Smith, so, you know, and Julia Pisani's from the Nanaimo. So you are attracting a crowd. And so basically my theme really is what happens on the land does matter. And you know, in terms of what I do, I'm a dot connector, and I just want to connect a couple of dots for you, because last week I was in Montreal. Our youngest daughter graduated from McGill, so on vacation. And these were all the med students. My daughter's in nursing. Anyway, so the keynote speaker, they gave me an honorary degree, and it was a big name guy from the States, and you know, a renowned surgeon, author, you know, writer of articles. And he got up, kind of give some words of wisdom to the graduating students. And he lit up by pointing out that we've just come through what he called the century of the molecule. And he used words like reductionism. You know, we've gone through a period where we're getting more and more narrow in our perspective. And then he said, but, you know, this century, the current century, will be the century of the system. And afterwards, when I talked to my kids, I said, you know, it's funny, you know, there's a cycle here, because We learn, we forget, we rediscover. Because when I graduated from university in the 70s, what was the big thing? Think like a system. Think like a system. So, and then it seemed like we lost it. But it's not just in the 70s we were right, because you know, one of my colleagues, Eric Bonham, who was long since retired from government, that you know, Eric likes to talk about the famous scene on the top of Mount Yosemite with Teddy Roosevelt and John Muir, who was the father of the U.S. State Park system. Because, you know, in 1903, John Muir's famous quote was, "Everything is connected." So every 50 years, we have to rediscover that everything's connected to this system. So in terms of where this is leading to, now I have to use this thing, right? Will it work? It did, okay. So I want to connect the dots to Ian Ricard, pretty renowned. So how many people in this room actually know the name Ian Ricard and Design for Nature? Of course, Pamela, you would, right? Yeah, so, I mean, half a century ago, when he started work on writing Design for Nature, and as I was waiting for this event to start this morning, I just looked through, here's the 25th anniversary edition, but, you know, Ricard is really, he's credited as being the father of GIS, as well as the father of ecological planning, because of his contributions, and this book changed everything when it was finally published in 69. In the preface to the 25th anniversary edition, it kind of provides a perspective on what he'd seen. And I actually found that probably more fascinating reading the book itself. And I just want to pick a couple sentences out of random, because I just said, century of the molecule, century of the system, and he said in 1967, when somebody said to him, we gotta write a book, he said, scientists had not yet discovered the environment. That was in 1967. So that's 50 years ago. And of course, some of you remember, you know, that was not long after Silent Spring. And so in terms of the impact that Design for Nature had, by the time it was published, it was 69. Well, you know what happened the next year? World Earth Day, and Richard Nixon formed the United States EPA. All those things flowed from this book. But it's really good to kind of have that perspective of how far we have come in only 50 years, because, you know, in terms of, here's another extract, Design with Nature aspired to satisfy several obvious deficiencies. Remember, this is 1967 we're talking about. The first was the absence of any knowledge of the environment and planning. That was only 50 years ago. This was a totally applied socioeconomic process. The next omission is the lack of integration within the environmental sciences. So one of the things that Ian Ricard did was really getting the first applications of an interdisciplinary team approach, because as he recognized, you know, one person doesn't know everything. So kind of a long-winded way to kind of set this up. If you go to our waterbucket.ca website, you can actually watch Ian Ricard, one of his last public presentations, when he kind of reflects on his lifetime of the process, where he actually said this, the shaping of life, the human use, ought to be based on an understanding of the natural process, let us dream the earth, your future. 50 years later, what Ian Ricard said still applies. It looks like I probably use about 5 minutes if I come back, right? And that's important. Because in terms of, as the keynote speaker, I'm here to inform you, to inspire you, to kind of set some enthusiasm and provide some food for thought. Probably too many dots for you to absorb today, but just touch on these dots. So in terms of the presentation, and it's too bad, you can't see me. Regional team approach and the sustainable watershed system. So the regional team approach really gives me a chance to reflect a little bit on what you're doing and how it relates to what we're doing. So this resilient future. Again, I'm coming at it from a water perspective, because it is the water that's kind of the center of all life. But this expression, regional team approach, as long as I have been a practicing professional, you know, we've always talked about the regional approach. And it was by accident a decade ago that we discovered the power of the word team. But we, for whatever reason, inserted the word team between regional and approach, and it changed everything. And I think that's really what the round table was about, that word, that sense of team. And then encouraging all players in the local government settings, I don't mind the word setting, because that's not saying who works for local government, it's, you know, this is the local government setting, to embrace shared responsibility. You know, we all have to do our part. Those are kind of two key concepts, which I think are universal in terms of who's being successful, and also to apply to your situation. So again, as part of, you know, this process we went through a back round of demonstrating how we can bring people together, Julie Sandy of the RDN is part of that. Again, we're talking in terms of mission possible. You can bring people together. The province, you know, those who provide the framework, local government, developers, First Nations, stewardship sector, agricultural sector, and Melissa pointed out to me, in this case, around the ballista, on, right? But it's an important concept. It is mission possible. You're proving it. And, you know, in terms of our British Columbia approach, and in the introduction, Stephanie mentioned giving presentations elsewhere. We use the word collaboration in British Columbia, and it means something to us. In other parts of the world, they don't really understand it. They don't understand our top-down, bottom-up approach because they just think differently. You know, and even going across Canada, it's more the prescriptive way of looking at things. But so for British Columbians, we have to keep that in mind, is that if we're talking to audiences outside of British Columbia, they don't really understand what we're doing because it may take us longer, but yeah, that's how we get there by building that consensus. So this is kind of important thing about agreeing on expectations, how we will work together. I think I heard that in the opening remarks by whether it was Finn or Robinson. So it's, you know, and then in the case of here, we got with Coco, not that you get to the same things, but once you agree on the expectations how to work together, then you can reach the goals in your own way. And so, and here's another key quote from Glenn Brown, who's now the general manager of UDCM, about the regional team approach is founded on partnerships and collaboration and seeks to align actions at 3CL, provincial, regional, and local. And that's a very important thought, aligning actions, because, you know, it's cascading. So this is the process. Can you see this okay with me standing here?
Okay.
Yeah. So this is what we call BC process. This is what the last 15 years, in terms of under the umbrella of the action plan, have been working with local government partners and others, kind of work through the what, so what, now what, then what approach. And I can tell you from the perspective of, as a professional engineer, the problem that societies have always had is beginning from what to so what. So, you know, again, I'll speak from the perspective of a water professional, a water guy. You know, we have floods and droughts, so we do reports, and then we put them back up on the shelf, and the cycle repeats itself. So we've always had this problem of getting to so what. So in terms of how we have worked with people and governments over the years, you know, what is the issue? Well, the form of land development impacts how water is used, how water runs off the land, how water reaches streams. It's being a thing like a system. So what can you do? Well, influence the designers, et cetera, to design the nature. And that's the significance of waiting around in the Clark's book, because, you know, that's kind of the starting point of how you think about your relationship with the land. Now what can we do? Well, embrace shared responsibility, and I'm sure Deborah Carlson will touch on that. That reads some work that the West Coast Environmental Law led as part of their contribution to the action plan years ago. Learn by doing, establish precedents. And I think, Finn, you used the word precedents, right? Learning by doing, establishing precedents, then replicate. And that's what makes us different in British Columbia than other places, in terms of it's not top down, because we have seen the power of sharing and learning in the local government setting. Sort of distilling this, in 2010, we released this list of 10 principles when we released Beyond the Guidebook 2010 at that time, you know, implementing a new culture for watershed protection and restoration of British Columbia. And so, you know, when we looked at what we were learning from folks in all over British Columbia, what did it come down to? Well, the first one was choosing to be enabled. That was I'm looking at this through the lens of local government. And, you know, the Local Government Act is an enabling act. So, you know, when you're enabled, it means you have a choice, choose to do it or choose not to do it. And too often in the past, people chose not to do things, so the challenge became choose to do it, choose to be enabled. And then establishing high expectations. That's what the roundtable is all about. Embracing a shared vision, isn't that what you're doing? Collaborating as a regional team, aligning and integrating efforts. I mean, when you write it down, it seems like a no-brainer, but it takes a process to figure it out. And if you give people the checklist up front, they say, oh yeah. But if you go through it yourself, the end of all, you'll find that's what it comes down to. Number six, celebrate innovation and successes. That is absolutely critical. And we went through a process ourselves in 2005 where we just threw away the work plan and started from scratch because in 2005, we had this notion that we were going to create a model subdivision development bylaw for British Columbia with a supporting set of standards. And so we had a first consultation workshop. It was with the regional engineers of Metro Vancouver. And we had them all around the table. And as they were just around, you know, introducing themselves, what they're doing, we saw this phenomenon take place. They go like, I didn't know you were doing that. You're doing that. And you know what we realized, and they told us, they said, we don't need another document to go on the shelf. We need to go see what people are doing. Because a lot of times people didn't know that they were being innovative, and that started the showcasing innovation series, and then we saw the power of learning on the bus. Connecting community advocacy, and that's what we're seeing right now, is really critical. And I've made a number of keynote presentations this year already, and there's something happening in British Columbia. There's a groundswell. And I was in Nanaimo on Thursday for a meeting that was with the Nanaimo Area Land Trust with Gail Adrian, and she was talking about their overwhelming volunteers. It's shades of what happened in the 90s when the whole stewardship sector movement got going with the Urban Sampling Habitat Program. I think, Finn, you had some great involvement. So something is rekindling from the 90s. And what happened in the 90s in British Columbia in terms of that stewardship sector-driven initiative, you know, that's what gave the momentum for a lot of the change that professionals such as I were able to accomplish over the last 20 years. Number eight, development from the town. That's what we've seen as absolutely critical with the demographic change of so many people with experience moving out. Who's going to mentor them? And it's kind of falling on kind of the old folks, like myself, to kind of pass on our knowledge by working with Julie Fasani, some of the RDN, right? And number nine, I highlighted because really at the end of the day, and unless you embrace shared responsibility, a lot of things just don't happen. And I think that's probably a characteristic of the round table. The last point being change the land ethic for the better, because I have found in my career, you know, people keep talking, it's either water or land, and they keep saying to the pillows, it's, so what you do on the land affects the water, right? And so you can't silo it, so water and land go together. I just wanted to quickly look at this one because my old friend of mine, Bill Mary out of Seattle, created this graphic while driving from Seattle to Vancouver for a workshop. You only have those 2 hours, 3 hours to reflect. And if you look at those words there, you know, how do you get from integrate perspectives and get to action? Well, you know, it all starts with education. And I always have to emphasize that I'm not using the word education. I am an engineer, right? So engineers are not supposed to be in education. But if you look at that in terms of the multiple pathways to get from education to action, so, you know, you can go various ways, right? I can sort of use it from one way by saying, okay, education leads to understanding, and then you can follow it down by ownership and action, or you can go the other way, education leads to participation, and you can go across to ownership, any number of combinations. But I think tying to where you are at now, in terms of, you know, critical success factors, what we see, well, commitment to take action, you know that, and deliver. The champions to provide energy. Without champions, nothing happens. And so part of what we've been doing on the Enrollment Action Plan for the last 10, 15 years is really connecting the channels so that you are not alone with this, that kind of thing. And then accountability, you have to deliver. Your credibility hinges on being able to deliver. When you say you're going to do something, you've got to do it. But then the last thing, resources to get the job done, right? And I think that's the essence of today's point, which is you can have all this going for you, but you've got to have the resources to get the job done. And you know, unless you're, and I guess that I'm looking at Julie, you'll be part of that story, right? Because in your case, as the RDN, you are dedicated to getting the job done. And so if you have all those factors going for you, it's inform, educate, inspire. Just a very quick reference to the Water Sustainability Action Plan, what is it we do, develop tools, develop talent, focus on outcomes. That's the whole point. And so in terms of, you know, you always have to have a Venn diagram to draw all these things, right? We've got the waterbucket.ca website, the waterbells.ca website, the tools. Right now, my focus is what we call the Georgia Basin Interregional Education Initiative. We actually got asked by five regional districts representing 75% of the population of British Columbia, and we keep going back to them, asking to have formal resolutions of support for their staff to collaborate, right, to share and learn, and kind of work towards, you know, what we all want to achieve in our own, way that is a consistency. So that's what it's all about. In terms of sustainable watershed systems, which is the our current focus under the umbrella of the Interregional Education Initiative, and with our funding through the federal provincial program, what do I mean by that? Again, it comes back to what happens on the land matters. We are looking at the water cycle with fresh eyes to develop new approaches, methodologies, and tools. And I re-emphasize looking at the water cycle differently because I've seen it with my kids, and I can kind of relate to what we have a grade period of time. Everybody understands the water cycle in grade 5. It's obvious by grade 8, they've forgotten the understanding. And yet we tend to make things really complicated, and I'm saying that as an engineer, we make things complicated unnecessarily, but if you just think simply in terms of the system, but what a water cycle is, because you all learned in grade 5, it hasn't changed. You know, it's a fundamental understanding. That's kind of the core piece of using language like sustainable watershed systems through asset management. I'm going to explain momentarily why we use that language. We've been going through a process in this problem. Everything's incremental. 2003 was the teachable year. The reason I say 2003 was the teachable year because we had forest fire, drought, forest fires. Remember what happened in 2003 with forest fires? Say it, Eric.
Kelowna.
Kelowna, right. Chris, you know, you've heard me talk before. And floods and pine needle exploded. So that was the teachable year. But what it created was that window of opportunity for the Water Sustainability Action Plan. Because that was 5 years after we released the a water conservation strategy for British Columbia. I was on that working group. And so 5 years later, the concept for kind of a five-year reflection of what had happened kind of morphed into the action plan. So, but the timing was perfect because we had the teachable year. But you know, that was 2003, 2008. Gordon Campbell set the framework in place for living water, smart, green communities, but it included 2014 for the three game changers, as I call them. So what happened in 2014? Well, the Water Sustainability Act. Developed with Care, 2014 version. First thing with Developed with Care, 2014, the two champions have retired, and it doesn't matter where you're at, if you don't have the champions, keep things going. And so I think that Developed with Care, 3 years later, people don't have the full appreciation for how significant it is. But the really important one, the linchpin, and I know the folks later on in the day is on the Water Sustainability Act, but the linchpin in the local government setting for change is asset management for sustainable service delivery, a framework for British Columbia. Why is that the linchpin? Because it's tied directly into funding, the grants. And what's the significance about sustainable service delivery? Well, it's reshaping how local government thinks about its assets because everyone's heard about the infrastructure liability. You know, the 20-80 rule, when you develop something, you pay the first 20%, but who's paying the other 80% of the time? The community, right? And hence, you have these multi-billion dollar deficits. Well, it's rethinking how we deal with how we finance our infrastructure, our water, our sewer, our roads, next to the watersheds, right? The next step is to integrate watershed systems, thinking into asset management. So we deliberately and consciously linked our language to the sustainable service delivery framework because when I go before a council or board, if I talk money, they listen. If I talk high-flying stuff, they're entertained. So Wally Wells, the executive director of Master Plan of BC. So, you know, for the past decade in BC, thought leaders have encouraged practitioners to think like a system rather than like an accountant. That's the transformation that's been taking place on basic asset management. And so, in terms of what we mean by sustainable service delivery, the focus is on desired outcomes. That's written into the BC framework. It's not about prescriptive methodology. That's what makes us different in British Columbia from other places. That's why other regions, the rest of Canada, are looking to British Columbia in terms of this philosophy. And it's about the service. So as soon as you get people talking about the service, it changes the conversation. And then you have to be able to ask yourself what services are important, what is the desired level of service, and how the service is delivered sustainably. So we're taking that language from asset management and applying it to watersheds. And voila, you know, introducing a new paradigm, watersheds as infrastructure assets. So that was November 2015 when we released Beyond the Guidebook 2015 and kind of introduced this notion of assets. And we weren't really sure how fast the uptake would be in terms of people embracing the idea, because you have to have the right language. And so I was really pleasantly surprised how within a matter of months people were embracing that language, because you get out like a group like this and say, a watershed is an integrated system. And you'll go, yeah, of course, right? And then we go to the next step, which is to say, the three pathways by which rainfall reaches streams, those are your infrastructure assets. So if you have assets, don't you want to protect them and manage them in a responsible way? And then once you've accepted that those are assets, well then they provide services. So what do I mean by the three pathways? Well, water flows over the land. Some water goes deep vertical to the groundwater, but most of the water in British Columbia goes to that very shallow soil layer. I'm sure you can right now. So that's the fundamental rethink, because traditionally we trashed, you know, our pathways by which water reaches streams. I'm going to give you three principles. So the first principle, which is maintain the portion of rainwater entering the stream by each pathway. That's why I said think back to grade 5, the water cycle, think on an annual basis, think how water gets from, you know, from there to there to there. Okay. The three pathways, surface runoff, that's minutes to hours, that's the stuff you see flowing down the street. Interflow, that takes from days to seasons, and deep runoff from years to decades. But water is always moving, so it's a time relationship. So if you start short-circuiting the pathways, that's the consequence we've been dealing with the last 50 years. Guiding principle number two, understand where the water goes naturally and reproduce those conditions. And it's taken us 15 years to kind of figure out the methodology. Just think about what McCarrick said in 1967. You know, when science people know the word environment, right? So you got to keep in context of how we have been progressing in general in society, a level of what we're doing in British Columbia. But if you just think in terms of, you know, on an annual basis, this table over here, you know, precipitation, you know, on an annual basis, you just look at, you know, the climate data, the stream flow data, and you realize, well, you know, 20% is losses. In terms of evaporation, plant transpiration, it's the other 80%. Look at the other 80% which you see in your stream flow. Where does that water come from? The water down the pathways. You've got to keep looking to make sure I'm not blocking your path. Direct runoff, 10%. Groundwater from aquifers, you know, 15%. Interflow, 55%. So think about that. More than half the water that falls in a year is in this shallow soil zone, moving horizontally, finding its way, and that's the pathway that we have been disrupting. And so that's been the essence of what we've been trying to do for the last 15 to 20 years in terms of changing the way we do things, is to restore the pathway that we damage the most. So look at Bill Bentley. As part of thinking differently, that statement, to protect watershed health, engineered infrastructure ought to fit into natural systems rather than the other way around. Think about it. Because I deliberately put a rain guard in an urban setting next to it because we tend to fall into the trap of thinking if we just plop a rain garden into place, that's the solution. Well, it's the start, but it's the fundamental rethink about which comes first. And so then in terms of the Water Sustainability Action Plan, we're living on the umbrella of the Regional Education Initiative, the twin pillars, as they call it. 2002, the province embraced the water balance methodology. So 2002 years till 2017. So in 15 years, you have to make progress, but it's often slow, often incremental. But we keep at it, because as we figured out how to do things, then we can implement. And now we're developing what we call the Ecological Economy Protocol as a tool to calculate the opportunity cost of drainage infrastructure. So if you just think in terms of opportunity cost, life cycle, in a watershed situation, the costs show up over time because you do something, you have progressive erosion and sedimentation, you have flooding down the road, there's always a cost. So what can you do differently so you don't incur those costs? So what does think like a watershed really mean? It means understand how the watershed has streams, the groundwater, aquifers, sites, and people. And again, you know, flipping through Ricard's book, I discovered a paragraph in his preface this morning where he actually refers to the fact that no consideration would be given to people 50 years ago. And he said, in terms of ecology, human behavior needs to be part of the adaptation, right? So he wrote that 50 years ago. So, and again, I'm just hitting highlights right in this brief time, but one of the tools we have developed and implemented through our local government partners is the Water Balance Model, Water Balance Express for landowners, because we realize, you know, the average person does not realize they live in a watershed. How do you connect them? How do you start to change their thinking? So it's part of the tool, it's a key part of the solution for protecting or restoring environmental flows. So again, literally when the other speakers get to talking about the Water Sustainability Act and environmental flows, what does that mean? Well, that comes back to how you manage the water balance, the changing climate, you know, how you're restoring the natural pathways so there will be flow. Just want to give you that, you know, take note. Coquitlam.waterbalance-express.ca. Coquitlam.waterbalance-express.ca. The tool is interfaced with Google Maps on Earth. So go home, go to that website, put in your address, and play with it. Because what that will allow you to do is move, you know, click and drag, drop and drag. Drag and drop, whatever you want to call it, and you know, with your property. Oh, 1 minute, okay. I forgot to remember the schedule, by the way. Because the journey to the water resilient future does start with the first rain garden. And so, even when I said you gotta think differently, you still gotta start somewhere. And what that does, you know, rain garden is a standard engineering detail, so you gotta find out the point of departure. Understand how to do rain gardens, just how to train them to look think differently in terms of there's three parameters you need to incorporate in your design to replicate how the water balance functions. And there's a volume, there's a release rate, and there's an infiltration area. And my last thought, cathedral thinking. And I give a lot of credit to Rick Anderson, who is the driving force behind cathedralthinking.com. Rick Anderson is the former head of the Vancouver Tourism, and cathedral thinking describes what I'm talking about. What is cathedral thinking? What comes to mind? Well, what should come to mind is cathedrals take hundreds of years to build, right? So, you know, there are four generations, there are eight generations. So when somebody starts to build a cathedral, or started to build a cathedral, 1,000 years ago, they knew they would never see the end, right? But people were working they were embarking on a journey. They thought about multiple generations. So what's the foundation? Think about your own plan, the far-reaching vision, the well-thought-out blueprint, and the shared commitment to long-term implementation. So in the era of the 8-second soundbite, this is a fundamentally different thinking. And on that note, I think I'm on time. But if you want to get our newsletters, the weekly newsletters, just send an email to outreach@waterbucket.ca.